Cool. Well, thanks everybody for coming out. I'm Mad Green. I'm a first-year MFA student at the Sam Fox School. I could not be more thrilled to introduce LJ Roberts as our Spring 2023 Prensky Visiting Artist to Island Press this week. I want to thank everyone for coming, and I want to thank the students who are going to be helping us out this week. We started doing some cool stuff today. And as well, I want to thank the Sam Fox School, Dean Carmen Colangelo, Director Amy Hauft, and obviously I want to thank Dr. Arthur Prensky, who has generously supported Island Press. LJ Roberts was taught to knit by their grandmother when they were 7, but they lost interest quite quickly. They reunited with their familial skill in college. Now, LJ is a visual artist and writer who makes large-scale textile installations, embroideries, artist books, and collages. Their work unravels moments of queer and trans history, inspired and ignited by politics, protest, and craft. LJ is unapologetically queer, and their artwork brings our history to life. Some of their influences are the Van Dykes, a lesbian van gang that traveled North America in the 70s, and Stormy De La Vure, a mixed-race butch lesbian drag king from Louisiana. They were a critical instigator in the Stonewall Uprising, yet they are often forgotten in the mainstream retellings. An example of LJ's use of activism in their work is their entry for the 2019 show, What is Feminist Art? For the Smithsonian Archives of American Art. LJ submitted a letter, quote, to whom it may concern, artists, curators, museum directors, archivists, and rural artists, artists of color, and artists who are LGBTQ or non-binary. In this letter, they proceeded to point out how artists of the latter description were left out of the original show in 1977, and their inclusion in the 2019 show is, quote, a curatorial priority. They go on to describe the irony of hosting a show to highlight feminism and then mandating the unpaid artists to donate their pieces to the museum's collection. If I were to tell you all of LJ's exhibitions and accolades, I would override our time limit. So here are some highlights. They have shown at the Smithsonian Museum of American Art, the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, and the Brooklyn Museum. In 2019, LJ was one of 9 recipients of the White House Champions of Change Award for LGBTQIA artists from President Obama. They also received a 2019 President's Award for Art and Activism from the Women's Caucus for Art. We're so happy to have you here, LJ. Please give me, or help me give them a warm welcome.
How do I dim the lights? Is that, could we dim the lights a little? I don't know, can you hear me up there? Is there any way to bring down the lights? There we go. Thanks so much, Mad, for that beautiful introduction. I just want to thank Lisa and Tom and everyone at Island Press and Sam Fox School of Art for inviting me here. It has been such a joy, even in the past 48 hours. I can't believe how much incredible work got made today. I'm really happy to be here. It's been a blast. And let's do an artist talk. So I actually show my work in chronological order, which is a little ironic because I'm such a nonlinear person. Nothing I do is straight. But we will kind of go through chronology. So when I was 15 years old, I was enrolled in an all-girls Episcopal boarding school in Maryland, which was a strange place to put a Jewish kid from Detroit. My parents sent me there, and I was extremely rebellious. I had just started coming out somewhat quietly, and I grew up about 20 minutes outside Detroit, My dad's side of the family has been in Detroit for five generations. We're like very rooted there. And you could basically sign up for field trips on the weekends at this school. And there was a field trip to go see the AIDS Memorial quilt in Washington, D.C., which was being laid out for the last time in its entirety because it had gotten too large to fit anywhere else. So this is during 1995. It's the kind of worst part of the AIDS crisis that we've seen thus far because AIDS is ongoing. And I was the only person that went on the field trip. It took me 2 weeks to put my name down because it felt, there was something about it that felt huge, and I was dealing with so many issues of sexuality and gender in 1995 at an all-girls Episcopal school. There was a lot of fear, but I went with one chaperone who I didn't know, and I walked around for hours, and it was the first time that I had seen any kind of signifiers or words that described anything having to do with kind of a queer sexuality or gender. And so it was extremely informative. It was very sad and frightening because so many people had died. And immediately there was an intertwining of the AIDS epidemic, looking at this quilt that is made and put together by so many different people, and coming out at that time. So, oh, it's someone's birthday. And happy birthday. And so I left school. I was actually kicked out of the all-girls Episcopal school. And I ended up going to the University of Vermont, which I was an environmental studies major at first. And then I was an English major. And then I started taking art classes just for fun. I finished my degree early. I was studying poetry and critical literary theory, and I was also really involved in the activist LGBT group on campus. I also lived in a radical environmental cooperative with a bunch of Earth Firsters, which was a very kind of guerrilla environmental group, and I would go with them, and because I was taking art classes, and at that time I was making photography in the dark room, which I really love, I would take pictures of them dropping banners on the tallest staple sign in the town, protesting old growth forest, clear cutting, or locking themselves to a pole with a bike lock. So I learned these kind of guerrilla skills from them. And at the time in Vermont, they were trying to pass something called civil unions, which was basically like gay marriage, but a little bit different. And so there was like a lot of kind of hate speech on campus. And so I knitted this pink triangle. It's very much in the spirit of activist groups and affinity groups of ACT UP who were doing banner drops. There's a really famous one that happened in Grand Central Station or on the CDC. So this is all hand knit. It was kind of one of my first experiments knitting my work. And it says Mom Knows Now. I figured this was a good way to tell my mother I was queer in college. Go big or go home. And so I snuck up the Ira Allen Chapel. I had a friend who was president of the student body and so had a key to every door on the university. We climbed up the tower, which was the tallest structure in Vermont. I don't know if it still is or not. And we hung this banner while classes were changing without permission. So I kind of started making art, very much doing institutional critique outside of gallery and museum settings, hanging things off of very tall buildings. And then I got to grad school. I did not expect to go get an MFA whatsoever. I thought I would be a lawyer, and suddenly I took, like, just on flying by the seat of my pants, applied to the textile department at California College of Arts and Crafts. And I started in 2004. And right when I started, they changed the name of the school. And a lot of people at CCAC were very unhappy about this. So as I was knitting my work and climbing buildings illegally, the morning of MFA Open Studios, I decided to, well, before this MFA Studios, I knitted the word and crafts, which had been removed from the sign. And it's hand-knit in bright orange yarn, put over plexiglass. And at 6 in the morning, I took the tallest ladder out of the school. And does anyone know what like E6000 glue is? You can't get it off of anything. So I climbed the ladder with the help of a few friends and tacked on these plexiglass letters with E6000 school or E6000 glue. And so that day were open studios, and there was just like a complete frenzy around the fact that this word had been inserted. And the story goes is I actually did not know that they were filming the promotional video for the school the next day. So this building was like very new and they were very excited. So they weren't super happy with me because I, like this whole film crew was coming to do this promotional video. But they couldn't really tell me to take it down either because it, you know, it's an art school and you should be able to kind of do what you want. And at that time there weren't surveillance cameras or anything like that. It was very easy. And so it stayed up for a week until communications kind of convinced the administration that it had to be, or the MFA program, that it should be taken down. But it actually went into the collection of the Oakland Museum of California in 2015. So it's on display all the time as part of their permanent collection, and there's a recorded oral history and some documentation. So it lives on. And then this was my first project out of grad school. It's a map of Brooklyn, and it maps out all of the collective houses, queer collective houses in Brooklyn. It is based on a map drawn by a friend of mine. Actually, the work that we're doing at Island Press stems a lot from this project. It's a continuation. But it's quilted in the middle, and then I started making a lot of my work. I was told that I didn't make work quickly enough, which is consistently still somewhat said to me at times. But I started making work on children's toy knitting machines, and I think there's a couple later in the presentation, but all of the words that you see are done on an instrument called a cool quarter, which is made for ages 8 and up, and a Barbie knitting machine that I got off of eBay that a professor showed me. The piece on the floor shows the key of the map, and the pink triangles have buttons inside of them. These are examples of the button. Every button has an illustration and the name of a house. So, for example, Denison has the Leather Daddy Devil. Handsome Transom was a houseboat on the Gowanus. It has an anchor. Unfortunately, that houseboat was destroyed in Hurricane Sandy. There's Fagala Farm, which has a bus that's a pony. Gaythorn, which is a limp-wristed vampire. And the piece has these buttons for takeaways. So Felix Gonzalez-Torres, his legacy has played a lot out in my work. So these buttons are free from the taking. This piece is part of the collection of the Renwick at the Smithsonian. It's actually up for a little bit longer as part of the show called This Present Moment. So you can, if you're going to DC, it's up right now. And I think they may have still have buttons left. But the point was, if this map was going into a collection, I really like to make projects that also exit the institution. So these buttons are seen, like I see the people wearing them around all the time, and they should be theoretically replenished endlessly so that they exit the museum. But yeah, this, I continue to make a lot of work like this. These giant quilts are always being made in my studio. They take a long time to make, but everything is done on kind of toy knitting machines, hand-sewn quilting, lots of applique. Which led to another project. Vanifesto is a zine made by a friend of mine, Hadassah Deluxe, who lived in one of these collective houses. This is also playing a lot into my work that we're doing right now at Island Press. This is a great zine. It's about queer conversion van culture. So a conversion van is kind of this little van that you see. You can sleep in them. My friend, her name is Hadassah Deluxe, but she goes by Damien. So Damien would take her like queer performance troupe around the country. There's lots of stories of wild dates, but that's also how to buy a van, how to maintain a van, where to park your van in Brooklyn. all different sorts of kind of, it's a part instruction manual, part stories, part practicalities. And at the time, I was really interested in bringing together the past, present, and future using queered fiber practices, wrestling and remixing lesbian, trans, and gender nonconforming and non-binary legacies, possibilities and problematics of queer alternative kinship, nomadism, landlessness, movement, and identity, dealing with post-apocalypse anxiety through imagination, desire, and speculative fiction. I'd been binge watching this movie, Born in Flames, that's directed by Lizzie Borden, that's incredible if you haven't seen it. Reading Parable of the Sower, and I should add N.K. Jemisin, the fifth season, and watching Stranger Things, which has incredible time travel in both directions, sometimes simultaneously, and there's like a great van part of the second season. And exploring my roots as a third generation Detroiter. My parents recently corrected me that it's fifth generation, and trying to loosen up and have some fun. So I'm very obsessed with cars and vehicles and road trips. This is a van that was at Slab City in California. I live most of the time now out in the Mojave Desert, though I'm back and forth between Brooklyn still. These are my dogs van camping. This is a van that I camped in for a while. The dogs play a big part in my work too. They'll come up over and over, Ziggy and Sparky. This was the original sketch for the piece. This is the piece in process. It's a show at Museum of Arts and Design where they basically moved my work, my studio, into the museum. I shared an entire floor of the museum with another artist, Sarah Sabata, who's also comes in later in the presentation as well, and got to work in the museum for 2.5 months. So you can kind of tell what's going on, which is the van quilt in the middle, but this is deep in process. And this is what it ended up like. It's 20 feet tall, or it's 14 feet tall, 20 feet long. I'm still trying to find a really good install shot so you can see the scale of it. It's called Van Dykes, Trans Van, Trans Gram X Dykes for the gender neutral, Trans Am, Dental Dam Dam. Again, it's made with, it's all hand quilted in the middle, Barbie knitting machine are these kind of knitted tubes on it. The writing is all done with cool quarter. Lots done, all of these kind of words on tools are shoelaces. And a friend of mine, Ariel Goldberg, was like, oh, it's words as tools. But there's its own, a lot of my work gets its own language. So all of the words on the tools are van words. So my favorite is actually van tankerous over the gas tank. But you have vampire and vaniversary and van date. And I'm not sure if you can see it, but there's a pitchfork at the top that says Vantichrist with Labrys pitchforks. So this took 6 years to make. It was showed really, it was showed in the middle, the worst, kind of worst of the pandemic at Toledo Museum of Art. But I'm currently working on trying to make a huge, not huge, I mean, I guess it's huge in scale, but a body of work of vehicles and vessels of this kind of post-apocalyptic queer and trans vehicles and vessels. So I have two ships in process now and a doom buggy that will be D-O-O-M, doom buggy, that's starting, you know, all sorts of kind of modes of transport. I use a lot of, you know, these are all zippers that came from Materials of the Arts. I sew them together. The tires are made from recycled bike inner tubes that are sewn together. So, and the headlights are, or the taillights and the headlights are hacked light brights. So I spent a summer buying light bright pegs off eBay. This was also part of MAD, so you can kind of see the cool quarter is that little toy in the middle that's for ages 8 and up. And I collect a lot of, you know, van and car paraphernalia, but there's also these kind of fiber instructions and work on my process. So I keep this archive of all of these things, and that's also a part important part of the project.
And then there came a point, there's come points in my studio practice where I haven't been able to afford a studio in New York City because studio space is very expensive, which I'm currently remedying at the moment. And I started a project where, after the Queer House map, I started embroidering portraits of my friends. And I did it because I could basically keep my studio in my tote bag. And so I carry an embroidery. I actually have one in my backpack right now with me. And I embroider wherever I go. It's just a complete habit. I do find it really meditative, but I like being constantly, I'm very nomadic, if you couldn't tell already. And so having my work with me all the time and being able to work no matter what, if I have a studio, if you're in quarantine and on lockdown, which I spent a lot of time doing in New York City, there was always work happening. And so this was one of the first portraits I made. It's my friend Ted Kerr, who actually does a lot of work in St. Louis on Robert Rayford and HIV/AIDS historical work that is specific to St. Louis. We went and marched it. This is the ACT UP 25th anniversary march on Wall Street. And so this is him holding a sign, wearing an ACT UP t-shirt from 2012. And then I also show the backs of the embroideries as well. And I'm really interested in showing both sides because it breaks down this kind of binary of abstraction and figurative work. I never thought I would make portraits. I thought figurative work was something that I wanted to really get away from. I felt like as a trans, like queer, non-binary person that representing a body, I was just like so sick of having my body entirely focused on that I was like, I don't want to do anything with bodies. I just want to not have anything to do with them. And then I realized that I grew up not seeing any images of trans or queer people. And I'm also really inspired by my friends. And work, like when I saw Catherine Opie's work, it was huge for me as a teenager. I was like, these are people that I relate to and I see them. But then there's also something more than the body, and that's where the backs of the embroidery come in. This is my friend Chris. I actually made a film with him and Ted, who you saw earlier, and Nick Nas, whose embroidery comes later in the presentation. But everyone is like a friend or a collaborator or someone I'm in community with, someone I've dated, some people are like embroidery, their embroideries of portraits of people who've dated my dates. It's like, you know, this kind of lovely pool of people who I orbit with in different ways. So the way, this is Alex Fialo, who is a curator, and Esther McGowan, who's executive director of Visual AIDS, which is an organization I've been very involved with since 2011, in front of Zoe Leonard's I Want a President. This was a very difficult one to do because I actually did it after Trump was elected, and it was just like completely mournful to stitch every single word. They're really small, they're 6 by 4 inches. So they're the size of snapshots. That was on the women's chainsaw crew at Idle Dandy Arts, which is a queer land project in Tennessee. This is Rosa, who drew the original Queer House map, singing at the Dyke March. I love the back of this one. I think it's my favorite back. That's Nick Nas. Nick Nas, actually, it's strange. Every time you talk, you find another connection, but they actually made the film that you'll see at the end of the presentation. We made a film together this past May. Frederick Weston, who was one of my closest friends, we marched together in Pride with Visual AIDS. He passed away in 2020. It's a great show up in New York right now at Gordon Robichaux. Fantastic artist. This is my friend Sarah Zapata, who's also my neighbor. Vivian Crockett, who is now a curator at the New Museum, who's been friend for a long time, sitting at the AIDS Memorial. It's right across from St. Vincent's. So this was also part of a visual AIDS event called Last Address, where you visit the last address where artists who have passed away of AIDS lived. So we this was at right across from St. Vincent. And this was an installation view of a show that I had at Pioneer Works. It's called Carry With Me, 10 Years of Portraits, and you can see how they're installed. They're framed, suspended in between glass, so you can actually turn the embroidery. So this is Lucchese Brafman Verissimo and H.H. Hyacin, and that's the back. So you're able to turn the frame like a book page. And the way that they're installed, you can kind of go through the gallery and turn every single one. We made a companion book that functions the same way. So you open the book and you see the first part of the verso of the embroidery, or the recto, and then you can turn and see the verso on the other side. And there's some really beautiful writing. A couple people who are in their embroideries wrote for the book as well. So speaking of books, I was actually talking a little bit about this to some of the students who are working with us today, which was really nice. I made this artist book starting in 2016. It was a project completely fueled out of rage. I was asked to make a project reimagining the George Siegel Stonewall Memorial that's in front of the Stonewall Bar, which is kind of these two what people assume are couples. They very much read as like a gay couple and a lesbian couple. And people had a really big issue with them, particularly around this film, when this film Stonewall was released, that very much centered cis, white, gay men and ignored a lot of contributors to gay liberation and Stonewall who were trans people, trans women of color, butches of color. There were laws at gay bars in New York where you couldn't have any kind of article that was considered, you know, of the quote-unquote opposite sex. And around the time that I was asked to reimagine this monument for a project, it was actually for Vice magazine, which feels so ironic because they seem to switch their politics from far left to far right every 2 years. But the New York Times, I'm a very obsessive New York Times reader, and they came out with this article that was basically like, gay men led Stonewall. And, you know, people wrote in and were like, yes, that was a big part of it, but there was, you know, this is ridiculous. You have to, this is not the whole story. And so they issued this correction, which was just as offensive, which says, this article also referred incompletely to the initial protesters at the Stonewall Inn. They were primarily gay men, not just gay men. There was at least one lesbian involved. And people like lost their minds, as did I. And I was living in the middle of nowhere in the desert in 2015. I had like nothing going on. I was having like a lull in my career. And I just like had an inkjet printer and I went nuts and basically started printing out all of these articles from the New York Times that after this article was published presented entirely different narratives of Stonewall. President Obama was making the Stonewall Inn a national monument, and it was like narrative after narrative that was completely different from one another. Well, I'm not interested in who threw the first brick. I think it's indicative of like a greater power struggle, and that's what I'm interested in, are these hierarchical power struggles and how narrative shapes those power struggles. And one of the things I started thinking about was a woman named Stormy DeLaverier, who was a mixed-race butch from New Orleans. She lived to be 96 years old. The New York Times wrote this gorgeous obituary of her when she passed away a few years earlier. And I was like, what happened? Like, why did she get forgotten in all of these articles? She wasn't even mentioned, and she had just died, and they had just written this obit because she was one of the instigators of Stonewall. But not only that, she was an incredible drag king. She performed with drag queens at the Apollo Theater. She was a bouncer at the Cubby Hole and Henrietta Hudson, which are two of the oldest lesbian bars in New York City that are still in operation. She was this guardian of people in the West Village who were queer and trans. She took care of lots and lots of men who were dying of AIDS during the AIDS crisis. She ended up growing old, being put into a nursing home. People did not know she was there because she had no next of kin. And the person who owns the cubbyhole actually became her guardian, and they got her out of there and took care of her until she died. But I was very interested in bringing her back and bringing her narrative and making her visible, because I needed to see someone like this growing up. Like, I needed to know that people lived beyond 30 years old, that they became adults, that they could flourish, that they could make a difference. And she was someone who I needed to see. My mom is also from Louisiana, so that felt, there felt like there was this connection because of how much silence within my family, and also like a queer family history that I have, that is very Southern, which is another talk. But what ended up happening with this book is that the Brooklyn Museum came to me and said, we want to do this show, Nobody Promised You Tomorrow, contemporary art 50 years after Stonewall, and we want to show the Queer House map. And we know that when we show it, it's going to be almost 10 years old. Do you want to make a new piece? And Goddess bless them, the curatorial collective said, what do you want to do? And I said, I want to make this book into giant microfiche, collaged microfiche light boxes, which I had never worked this way before. And they said, okay. So, you know, curators giving, I have to say, like, curators putting their trust in me to make this piece was career changing and life changing. Carmen Aramo, it's actually her birthday today, who's the curator at the Sackler, was really on board. So I took the pages from this book and made them into these 14 light boxes. It starts with this correction. So you see the correction, and then there's repetition all around the piece. What we did was we put a four-channel oscillator on the piece. So these boxes blink every so often, which emphasizes their repetition. So you have this kind of correction, and then the smaller box echoes this kind of at least one lesbian over and over. And then it moves you through this story of Stormy DeLaverier, but not only that, it talks about narrative and anti-narrative that I think is really important to consider when we look at queer and trans histories. And it takes, the language is all from the New York Times. It's remixed New York Times article, including an article that's an interview with Susan Stryker, who's a really incredible trans scholar, that talks about these kind of power struggles and how they play out in this conflict over the first brick or shot glass or high heel or whatever it was. There is a narrative that Stormy threw the first punch and said, do something, to the rest of the crowd as she was arrested and hit in the head. So this box will blink on the oscillator. There's actually a video that's very unedited in RAW on my website because I haven't gotten around to it. But this is the oscillator. This was installed. This was a big moment of plugging everything in after months and months of working on it. This actually brings me to one of the most recent pieces I've made, which I haven't talked about yet. So we'll see how this goes. But this is a commission that was done for a show called 52 Artists. It was a show at the Aldrich Contemporary Art Museum. And it was similar to the exhibition that Mad described in their beautiful introduction, where they had staged a show at the Aldrich in the 70s, and they had included, something like 25 artists in the show, and they had responded, it was kind of like, what is feminist art? And artists responded to this work. So there was really incredible artists like Howardina Pindell, was one of the artists who I really love, who was in the first show, and then they invited kind of this new group in. So there was a lot of land art happening in that show that I was really inspired by. And I asked the curator, Amy Smith Stewart, who was also one of those curators, when I proposed the project, she was like, sounds great. If I could dig up the sculpture garden of the Aldrich and grab a bunch of stones from it. Ridgefield, Connecticut has stone walls over it. It's a very, very colonized and violent history. It has an incredible history of violence and colonization there. The Aldrich Museum is built on stone walls. And I, Stonewall is something that I had been thinking about. And Stonewall could be a really big revolutionary act. That's what we think about. But I also think of it as this kind of these smaller revolutions that happened. So I dug these stones from the Aldrich and Ridgefield to think about place and kind of this earth-based art. But it so happens that my camp counselor from when I was 13 years old and sent to fat camp by my parents in upstate New York lives in Ridgefield. And she was the first queer person I ever met. She was very out when she was my camp counselor in 1993. And she took me under her wing and she wrote me letters like every 6 to 8 weeks for 2 years. And they completely kept me alive and we're still in touch. We have like almost 30-year friendship now. And so I took rocks from her yard and built this stone wall. So it's this collective stone wall. I actually also found a brick at the Aldrich, so there is this like one brick at the bottom. And the plinth is made of steel. It's got a light box inside. The photograph on the front was taken in Detroit. Someone had spray painted Dyke in huge letters on the side of this building. The other side is a photograph from the desert. It is kind of this cloth that's embedded into dirt. And then you can kind of see it in this photo, but there's a little television embedded into the rocks that looks like a stone with a video that my friend Nick Noss made, who was in the embroidery, of me digging up the stones at the Aldrich. And the Aldrich made this really nice video for me of the work. It's a little hard to see in slides. So this show just closed in January, and the rocks were returned back to the grounds of the Aldrich in my camp counselor's yard down the street from the museum. But I really wanted to show, you know, I think that's like a theme that goes throughout the work, that you know, there are these big kind of monumental occasions. We can have all these queer houses in Brooklyn, but it's a lot of individual small acts, relationships, connections, people who are doing these kind of small things every single day to build this kind of larger collective power. And, I think that's really continuing on this project that we're doing at Island Press right now in terms of communities coming together to provide resources to help one another all over the country, which is particularly important right now considering the political climate. So this was me very much struggling to dig up rocks over the course of 3 days from the Aldrich. A funny thing about this is there's actually a piece in the sculpture garden that's a really old Karen Finley piece that is on a rock also, and it's a poem about HIV and AIDS, just to circle back around to the beginning. And it's like completely covered with vines. And I kind of love, it's again, like a circling back around. And that's the end of my talk. I'll end it with, this is a print that we just made. We made it a couple weeks ago. Actually, it's an edition of 5. And these are Ziggy and Sparky with Perfect Lovers. Perfect Lovers, Perfect Brothers, this is another tangent. The lightbox pieces, all of the wiring that was used is surplus Felix Gonzalez Torres, Untitled America, from the restoration of that. All my work is done, all my fabrication is done by Light Bright Neon in Kingston, New York. So they're unbelievably creative, thoughtful, genius. Matt Dilling, who works there, used the surplus cord from Untitled America restoration to wire Stormy at Stonewall, which is now at the National, it's in the collection of the National Portrait Gallery and should go up next summer and as part of their permanent collection. So thank you so much. I can take questions. Do we want to put the lights on? I can take some questions if anyone has them. Yeah.
I'm curious how you think of the word craft, and if you had imposed it on the building.
Yeah, that's such a great question. I actually wrote my master's thesis on the word craft. So the interesting thing about the word is that my master's thesis was basically about how craft and the word queer are very similar and how they function. And both words have what is called a loose terministic, it's called a terministic screen. And it's basically a word that's used in rhetoric. Like, I worked with a professor in the rhetoric department at Berkeley who explained to me that what words don't mean are just as important as what words mean. So we know what, say, you know, a chair is, and we understand what a chair is not, right? So a chair can be certain things, we know what it looks like, but we know that, like, there are certain things that are, what is not is just as important as what is. And crafts is, like, so loose. Like, there's so many things that can be craft, right? Like, we can think of studio pottery, and we can think of, like, a grandma knitting pot holders, and we can think of a kid at summer camp, and we can think of, like, a Dale Chihuly, like, light fixture, which is, I think there's one in the hotel I'm staying at here. And, you know, and we can think of, like, it's all over the place. And queer functions like that, too, because you can't, there's no kind of, you know, queer was deployed a lot during the AIDS crisis because it encompassed so many different kind of configurations of identity. So there was this really great way to kind of reconsider the word craft, taking advantage of that loose definition, saying like, oh, this can be anything. Why are we dwelling in this kind of stigma that this word carries rather than all of the possibilities it has to represent so many different kinds of people? So there was so much, I mean, people were aghast when they took the name off. And it was like MAD did it at the same time and a bunch of other institutions. And now you see the word craft, like there's Craft Contemporary in Los Angeles and like all these institutions renaming themselves to have like craft in the name. So words change over time. And, you know, I find that all the time. Like I'm constantly having to be like changing the words I use to describe myself, which is why teaching has been really helpful because a lot of my students are like, do you know this word, agender? And I'm like, I've never heard of that word. And then I'm like, oh, that totally describes me. And using it. So I think that, you know, for me, craft, I find that it sits on the margins like queer does. And if it gets pushed towards the center, it reinvents itself to go back out. So there's always a questioning of the center that happens. It doesn't, there's no stasis, and it stays really productive in that way. And it's taking a system of power. And it's funny because when I walk around and go to meet, I'm compulsive about art, so I'm like always in museums and galleries. There's so much craft everywhere. It's like ceramics, textiles, glass, so much of it. And it's interesting to talk to my friends who work in those mediums and are showing work. And how they feel about it. Because some of them are like, oh yeah, I completely embrace that. And some are like, yeah, that's not a word I'm still uncomfortable with you comfortable using. But I really enjoy thinking about it in that way. So, thanks, that's a great question. Yeah, it's been, I love working with galleries and museums right now. The support has been really wonderful for the projects, and I still do a lot of making sure projects exit the institution in a way, so that's always been a part of it. I think that I'm always very, I'm always a little nervous about how I'm positioned in institutions in terms of like the ways that I'm talked about and the way history is talked about. I do a lot of talking to I think I've just been so lucky with who I've worked with, because everyone is willing to sit down with me and talk through projects a lot. You know, I'm also someone who is very concerned with being paid and making sure other people get paid. So one of the projects that I'm really proud of is, I should show it in my talks, I don't know why I don't, but there was a show at the Brooklyn Museum in 2015 that I was in. It was called Agitprop, and the way that they structured it was, it was like a similar thing where like they had a group of feminist artists, and then those feminist artists the artists got to pick out themselves another artist to put in the second wave. There was three waves, so first wave, second wave, third wave, very feminism. And I was in the third wave because I was like a baby. And Dyke Action Machine put me into the show, this Brooklyn Museum show. And I worked with visual aids to create, visual aids had a series called PlaySmart, and they're like baseball cards, but they have pictures of people on the cards, and then they have facts about HIV and AIDS on the back, either prevention, treatment, politics, stigma. And at that point, they had done 5 editions. Three of them had been cis men. One of them had been all trans men, and the other had been like queer, like craft. It was interesting. It was like, it wasn't me. It was like a queer craft in AIDS. And I was like, where are like women in this? Because women live and die with HIV all the time. And I'm talking about women of all genders and identities. So I got on the phone, and I called Tourmaline, and I called Jessica Whitbread, and I called Jean Foos, who did a lot of work for David Wojnarowicz, and we assembled a group of 11 women of all genders, HIV, Kia Labasia, all genders, all sexualities, HIV positive, HIV negative, unknown. Their ages ranged for people in their 20s to their 60s and all ages in between. And we made a packet that was in the museum of these cards. And they always give out like lube and an external condom, but we also put an internal condom because the trans woman we worked with was like, this is really important to have in this. So you could get the packet in the museum, but it always exited the museum. And we also did a pay structure where there was the pay was like pyramided so that like women living with HIV and trans women and women of color got more of that payout according to like kind of a lot of the white supremacy at work in terms of the institution. So it was really important that we were able to like divvy that out. And the way that I work with institutions also is I work with a lot of collaborators. So like opening that gate and listing a lot of other artists within like my work, that always happens. Like it'll be like LJ Roberts and like all these other people. So it's a lot for me. I love working with curators. I love having my work in museums. I love a 5-day install with like 2 cherry pickers and a bunch of like dudes I'm ordering around. And like a bunch of other artists who haven't shown in the museum that are like now in the museum. So I try to be very strategic about how I work. And I always work in a like, even that letter that I wrote to the Archives of American Art, actually the curator, she's a fantastic curator and I love working with her, and she curated this present moment that the queer map is up in now. But she was like, yeah, this letter is like really, you know, you're saying that us not paying you prevents you from making feminist art. Like, you have to hustle when we don't pay you. You know, that's when, you know, I have my, like, I teach part-time at Parsons, but, like, a dog walk to, you know, like, it's like, where do I scrape together that money that you're not paying me that takes away from my studio practice because I have to pay this healthcare deductible? So those, like, basic necessities for living, that's been really important. You know, I'm not perfect. Like, I still don't ask for certain things where I'm like, oh, I should have actually asked for this, you know? So I hope that's helpful. It's murky, you know? It's like, I never thought I would show up. I just joined a gallery, and I never thought that would happen for me, ever, until I was dead. I was like, you know, I'll be 80 and joining this really great gallery in New York called Alexander Gray that represents Harmony Hammond, because she used to be like, you know, I had to turn 70, but it happened. Like, there was always that narrative growing up, and that's not true anymore. So it's also like I'm learning how to work with that too, and it's been a big learning experience. Yeah. I teach professional practices, so I talk about this. I could talk about it all day long. Lisa. Yeah. Yeah, I am so excited about the project, and it's been incredible how much has gotten accomplished today. It's mind-blowing, but I'm making my first show for the gallery, which will be in fall of 2024, and it's a lot about being on, like, being a queer trans person and being on a road trip, because I love being, I grew up in cars in Detroit and loving cars, and I love being on road trips, and it's also like one of the scariest, I come into kind of some of the scariest situations in my life on road trips. Using the bathroom is really hard on road trips. It's been like the worst bathroom incidents I've had, which I have like every single time I use the bathroom, because I tend to use women's rooms, have been really unsavory situations. And for me, in 2020, I lost my closest friend, Frederick Weston, and my partner's mom, and we, like, hit the road. We were, like, we had been in New York City. We hit the road. We drove to the desert where we had a cabin with no running water and no electricity, and we're just, like, we're gonna figure this out. And that road trip was, it was like traveling with queer ghosts. And so I'm making this show that's got a lot of different mediums about this kind of experience of being on a road trip and the music and the kind of friendship and the camaraderie. And one of the things that Lisa and Tom and I kind of started talking about was the kind of queer and trans auto mechanic collectives that exist around the country and what an incredible resource that is. And in doing, the first thing I came upon was actually something called the Women's Car Collective that was in St. Louis. It was like the first thing that I found. And it blew my mind. I was like struggling with what I wanted to do here, and I saw this flyer. So we're making this map of historical and contemporary queer and trans auto mechanic shops around the United States and Canada. And the histories of them, there's like the best classified ads I've ever seen of like, you know, an auto mechanic looking to join a women's land project and like listing her skills, which are, it's like gardening and replacing your spark plugs. It's really great. So the map really builds on, I feel like it's a bringing together of this like queer house map that has been such a big part of my life in Brooklyn and my practice, and then this love, this like van, vehicle, and vessel project to have this map, this historical map. And then we're also, I keep a photo archive of all of the pictures that I take on road trips, and Tom has started making these really gorgeous etchings that are very small and ghostly of some of these photos. So it's kind of a two-pronged project that's very similar to the practice of this kind of larger map of people that have come together to provide this car care resource. I don't know if you've ever, like, going to the mechanic is also sometimes terrifying. I did that on Friday because my car is falling apart and has no AC or heat at the moment. But, you know, I think that the smaller prints are kind of like the things that live inside the road trip, similar to how the embroideries function a little bit with the queer house map. So it's been really fun. It's been kind of hilarious, too, because these, like, historical and contemporary queer auto mechanics have great sense of humor. So their ads and their graphics are hilarious and really kind of smutty and fun. So, yeah. I think that's, yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.